ニュースの裏側を考察するシリーズ。今回のニュースは米中対立の板挟みになった NVIDIA の悲哀と知っておきたい NPU と GPU の違いについて語ります。最初にニュースの概要、その次に GPU と NPU の違い、最後に友の会でお送りしたこれに関しての革ジャンことジェンスンのとっても楽しいインタビュー動画をお送りします。それじゃあ最後まで楽しんでいってね。ニュースの概要。フアン氏によると、米国の輸出規制の影響で NVIDIA は中国の AI サーバー市場から完全撤退。かつて約 95% を誇ったシェアがゼロになったと明かしました。2022年以降の規制強化で A100、H100、H200 などの主要 GPU が中国企業へ出荷できなくなり、同社は中国からの収益をすべてゼロと想定しています。禁止対象の A100、H100、H200 は AI モデルの学習を行う際に使われる NVIDIA の主力 GPU です。いずれも高帯域メモリ HBM と数千コアの並列演算構造を持ち、生成 AI の訓練で欠かせない存在です。しかしこれらの輸出は米国の輸出管理規則により全面禁止。 NVIDIA は性能を制限した H20 などを設計しましたが、2025年4月の追加規制でこれも対象となりました。つまり抜け道まで封じられたという状況です。中国当局は先進半導体の輸入検査を強化して入り口を完全に塞いでいます。その一方でバイトダンスやアリババといった主要 IT 企業には NVIDIA 製チップの新規発注を停止するよう指示したと報じられています。つまり NVIDIA 製 GPU を組み込んだサーバ構築やクラスター運用も実質的に停止せざるを得ない。在庫チップがあったとしても中国企業が堂々とそれを使うことはできないんです。なのでゲイマーズネクサスのドキュメントで取り上げられたように闇市場が形成されるわけです。一方中国ではファーウェイやカンブリコンが代替チップ開発を加速。そのためファーウェイやカンブリコンのチップが高騰し、数ユエンシリーズの市場価格は前年同期比で約3倍に上昇しているとの報告もあります。これらは今に始まったことでもなく、先端産業と地政学は深い関わりがあります。今回特徴的なのは、結果的に米国が中国の半導体自立を後押ししたという事実。 NVIDIA が撤退した穴をファーウェイやカンブリコンが即座に埋めている構図です。 NVIDIA としては中国市場を失っても北米、中東のクラウド需要が爆発的に伸びているため、短期的な業績に打撃はない模様。ただし長期的には非常にまずくって、それは中国の AI 研究者が自国製チップ上で育ってしまうこと。世界中のCUDA開発者の半分ほどが中国に関わる仕事の人だという話もあります。ジェンスンのCUDAエコシステムによる支配が崩れてしまう可能性さえあります。 GPU と NPU は違うよというお話。このニュースで出てきたアセンドやスーユエンですけれど、これらは GPU ではなく NPU の部類に入ります。そして、自作界隈で出てくる NPU ではなく、データセンター用の NPU です。ここら辺がごっちゃになると、最近のニュースの本当の意味するところがあやふやになっちゃいますので、ここで解説いたします。NPU とは、ニューラルプロセッシングユニットのこと。中身はテンサーコアばっかり入ってるイメージ。私たちが購入するような AI ノート PC、 例えばコパイロットとかが得意なノート PC なんかに入ってたりしますけれど、これはコンシューマ向けの NPU です。コンシューマ向けの NPU は推論特化で省電力なのが売り。ノート PC だと冷却とかバッテリーの持ちとかを気にしないといけないから、 AI 推論目的ならば GPU よりも NPU が好まれたりします。データセンター用の NPU はノート PC の NPU のような推論特化ではないです。行列演算に特化したプロセッシングユニット、つまり学習や推論どっちもいける。それに NVIDIA の NV リンクに似た構造のクラスターを組むことができて、 NVIDIA ほど優秀じゃないけれどスケーラビリティもあるって言えばある。それじゃあ GPU と何が違うのかというと、 GPU は HPC、つまりスーパーコンピュータみたいな高度な科学技術計算とか AI とか、用途が幅広い。クーダエコシステムみたいに過去の資産があるから、既存アプリケーションも動くし、新規のアプリケーション開発もしやすい。それにハード自体も成熟してるから、ノウハウが豊富。こう聞くと、GPU の方がすごくよく聞こえますけれど、そのデータセンターの使用用途が AI だけに限られていたらどうでしょう。そしてそもそも、NVIDIA GPU が手に入りにくいとしたら？それならば、最初から AI に特化した設計のデータセンター向け NPU の方がいいわけです。AI というのは、結局中身は行列の計算をひたすら繰り返すようなものです。その点、データセンター用の NPU なら、行列計算に特化してる。推論だけじゃなく、学習も大量に回すための効率、スケーラビリティに優れてるんです。NVIDIA GPU のデータセンターが手に入るなら、過去の資産も使えるし、いろんな企業が共有できるし、新しいアプリケーションも作りやすいし、メンテナンスのノウハウもある。カリカリチューンされた NPU には、スループットが若干劣るかもしれないけれど、これなら安心ってところが一番でかい。対してデータセンター用 NPU は、誤解を恐れずに言えば、一つのことしかできない F1 カーのようなもの。直線ではめちゃくちゃ速いけど、何でもそれ一台でこなせるかと言われれば、そんなことない。しかも AI の計算なら何でもござれ、というわけでもなく、その企業が得意とする AI モデルに特化したデザインに合わせる方が早い。それか、他の企業がそのデータセンターを使いたいのであれば、アプリケーションをハードに寄せる工夫をしないといけない。GPU とデータセンター用 NPU、どちらが良い悪いではなく、用途によって使い分けるのが良しとされています。語弊はありますけれど、基本的にカリカリチューンされたソフトウェアならば、GPU より NPU で動く方が処理速度が速いです。例えば、Google の TPU、Amazon のトレイニアム2なんかは、大きな括りで分ければデータセンター用の NPU の仲間。それなのに、アセンドの場合、NVIDIA GPU の 80% 程度の速度しか出ていない、という報道がありました。ベンチ環境が何なのか詳細不明なので一概には言えませんが、だから、ソフトウェアの最適化、クーダのようなエコシステムの強化、中国国内でたくさん使ってもらって、ノウハウをたくさん蓄積する努力なんかが必要なんだな。で、このニュースからわかるんですね。
You've taught us that this is the fourth industrial revolution and that there are room pretty much for everybody. So, surprising that Lisa Su and AMD team up with OpenAI after you just teamed up, or welcoming to some degree because you need to have everybody doing this in order to make it so that you're not the gating factor because you can't make everybody's chips.
We could try.
Well, all right, but I mean, AMD, you know,
give us a chance.
Well,
you could count on me. You can count on me.
Lisa, we're here. I think she said the MI450 is every bit equal to yours. And I would say I want to hear from Jensen because that's a chip. You're a platform and you're software. You're loaded with software. And so therefore, a piece of hardware may not be equal to it for total cost of ownership.
We do very different. We build some things that are similar in category, but we're very different companies. You know, NVIDIA started out as a graphics chip company, and over time we became a computing platform company. And a computing platform company is largely software, and you have a lot of developers and ecosystem that create other software that sits on top of your computer. We became a computer platform company. When artificial intelligence came along, we realized that artificial intelligence are really large computers, and the entire data center is essentially one computer. And so we went off to work on distributed computing, using multiple computers working together into one giant system. So networking matters, switching matters, tons of software is involved. And so today, when you look at the computers we make, they're, you know, 1,000 acres large. It's a giant system. Hundreds of megawatts, you know, gigawatts at a time. And that's the reason why a new industry has emerged. This industry requires factories that manufacture numbers, which when reformulated becomes intelligence. And so it's an intelligence manufacturing factory. And that's the, you know, this new industry produces the most valuable thing the world's ever known, intelligence. And so our company builds these large infrastructures, and it's got lots of technology inside. The GPU, which we invented in 1996, I think it is one of the technologies inside, but there's a whole bunch of technologies. And so we're different.
Let me ask you a question about the recent deal that you made with Intel. Now, I know Intel I knew Andy Grove, and a person on the board who suggested that they make a deal with a company that sounds a lot like you during the period when I know you were speaking to Andy. And Andy was quite disrespectful, but that was his way. He just was his way. It's not the way, it's the way that he had himself set himself up, frankly.
Intel dedicated 33 years of our lives trying to kill us.
Right. And then a man whom I heard you make a test.
That was actually a mission.
But that's absolutely true. I mean, from my point of view, from the board member who said, listen, we have to destroy these guys. However,
not dead yet.
A new man, Lip Bhutan, comes in. I heard you give a testimonial to him in the 2022 Noyce Awards that was gracious, and it made me think, wow, there could be not only just a detente, but maybe one day they'll be talking to each other. This is an important deal for you, isn't it?
You know, we're lovers, not fighters. and it is true. It's true that it is. If you have an imagination about the future, it is possible to bring other people along. And I always like it. I always like it when we give a keynote, everybody's stock price goes up. When somebody else gives a keynote, our stock price goes down.
Yes.
And it says that the way we see the world, the way we see the future, is inclusive for other people, and we create opportunities that brings other people along. Our partnership with Intel. Is because I can imagine a future for the both of us where we could both win and not one of us have to win, the other one to lose. And this partnership brings them into our ecosystem, and so they're going to build a custom microprocessor for us. We're going to also build a custom microprocessor for a new market. And so there are two new products that comes along from this partnership. And also, you know, we invested $5 billion in them, which is, no small amount.
Now
I'm an Intel shareholder.
Why not? I mean, you're a big shareholder.
And ever since I invested, it went up something like 50% or something.
Well, I mean, we don't have an open AI valuation, but I think that there were a lot of people who questioned that they were trying to figure out whether there was some sort of circular nonsense, but obviously, clearly from events, not. But what bothered me is that people don't realize how good an investor you are. I actually have a friend who made a pitch in front of you. And they didn't expect to see you. They expected to see minions. But you were there, and you drilled them for 3 hours of questions. You make these investments, don't you?
Well, you know, it's for us, we make good investments. And the reason for that is because, well, first of all, we're smart. but the reason why we invest is because we imagine building something together. And so when we wanted to create a new type of cloud, we invested in a small company called CoreWeave, and then we helped them build themselves into a company, and they went public, and we made a fortune, and that was fantastic. It was great for them. It was great for us. Now we're going to invest in OpenAI, potentially invest in OpenAI. It's a great privilege, and I'm very grateful that they invited us to invest. But the partnership of OpenAI is really, it's incremental to all of the work that we've done with Azure and OCI and CoreWeave, and so we're going to build up a whole bunch of capacity for computing for them because AI needs a lot of compute. This is a partnership that for the first time, OpenAI is going to buy directly from us. Usually, a cloud service provider buys from us, and they rent from a cloud service provider. And so now it's going to be a direct partnership. We're going to help them build an AI infrastructure that they operate themselves and really set them up for, 5 years out when they're going to operate their own cloud anyhow. And so it's a great partnership.
Do you think we're all waiting for trade talks, or have you gotten less optimistic than you were last time I talked to you, that there'll be something that allows, let's say, commerce with us in China?
Well, first of all, if there are any you know, investors, all of our guidance assumes China zero. And so if anything works out with China, it will be a bonus for us. And now China is a very large market. It's a very important market. But let's take a step back. I think the policymakers want a great outcome for America. And they want America to win. President Trump wants America to win the AI race. This is an important technology period, and AI is going to be foundational and transformative to every single country. President Trump wants America to win the AI race. And so the question is how to do that? How to ensure that American companies have all the best NVIDIA technology and the best chip technology on the one hand. On the other hand, understanding that in order to succeed at AI, we really want the world to build on the American tech stack. Just as we want the world to be built on the American dollar, we would like the world to be built on the American tech stack, including developers in China. And so this is that balance of how do we ensure that American companies get the best technology on the one hand, but also on the other hand, provide the technology to Chinese companies so that China could be built on American technologies. And this finesse, this nuance, is a delicate balance, and this is where policymakers will have to wrestle with some of this. And I hope that we find a good place. A complete ban is not good for American companies long term. It might hurt Chinese companies, a complete ban, but it hurts American companies worse long term. And so I think this observation, this realization, and this nature of AI and the computer industry, I hope is understood, and that we can work this out someday. But until it gets worked out, we should just assume it's zero. And I hope that we can get back to China someday.
I know you said zero, but you were optimistic that something good could happen. Do you still feel that way?
Well, I'm always optimistic,
okay,
Jim.
Fair enough. Yeah. You are always optimistic.
I'm always optimistic.
No, and because, I buy into that.
I'm always optimistic. And because on first principles, it makes sense for America to win.
Okay.
It's a pro-America policy. It's great for American technology. If America wants to win the global AI race, we want the whole world to be building on American tech stack. Just as we want, you know, the whole world to be building on the internet that was really invented here in the United States, we want the whole world to be building on Windows. We want the whole world to be building on, you know, AWS or Apple, or we want the whole world to be building on that. That's a good thing. It helps American industry, helps American companies, and it allows the world's every country to be built on American technology. That's a good thing.
Coming up. まとめ。RTX50 シリーズのコネクタ誘拐問題、ドライバの不具合。早くどうにかしてほしいですけれど、そんな暇が全くなさそうです。最近のジェンスンのインタビューからは、ゲーム業界は成り上がるための踏み台だった、くらいの勢いの発言がありました。2010年頃からは、もう AI に舵を切っています。数多くの大学を回り、いろんな教授に直接会って、クーダを使ってもらうように営業をやってました。ただし、取締役会が GForce を辞めてしまえ、と迫る中、それを断固として反対したのがジェンスンだったという話も聞いたことがあります。彼はかつてセガに助けられたことがありました。損得感情だけでは割り切れない、エモーショナルな何かがあるのかもしれません。以上です。ご視聴ありがとうございました。